phone call. The man does not identify himself. He just says, Mr. Simon, your husband has been arrested and he's in this town. And come out. And my mother had heard rumors of people being arrested and never heard from again. She didn't know what to do. She could not call up her parents. She could not call up her sisters. She couldn't call up her friends because they wouldn't know anyway and they wouldn't say anything. So she remembered, because my mother was a piano teacher, that one of the students, her father was a police officer. She called him and he answered the phone and she started to tell him what, and she said, stop, I'll be over. So he came over and she told him the story about the phone call and everything. And she said, I have to go there, I have to get my husband. And he said, you're not going anywhere. He said, I am going to go. He said, can you imagine what would happen if I go there with a Jewish woman? He said, you and I would get arrested, and that would be the end of it. He said, let me go by myself. Let me see what I can do. And he did. And he went to the station. He saw my father with other men sitting and passed right by him, didn't acknowledge him, was able to see the head honcho at the police station, and spoke with him, walked out, winked at my father, and went out. About an hour later, they released my father, but not before he was taken throughout the street with a big placard that said, I'm a Jewish pig. And then he had been able to do it. So of course, my parents decided, well, now is the time to immigrate. But in order to immigrate, you need passports, you need paperwork. But my father already had police information. He couldn't go and get the information. So the underground was already in effect. And my father went under the darkness of the night, went through those channels and wound up in France, in Paris. Sent my mother a wire saying, aunt, whatever is doing well. And that meant that he was there and everything was fine. Now my mother had to, take care of the children and that he wound up everything. And she had a passport to Italy, where one of my father's brothers lived. And that's how she eventually got us there. And my sister at the time was still with my grandparents in another town, but she took me and we went to Italy, and his brother got my sister to come and to Italy, and we took a train to Paris. And the one thing I really, really remember is we got into the railroad station, the train came in, and I looked out through the window, and there's a man standing there with flowers in his hand for my mother. It was my father. Oh. So, my mother said, how can you spend so much money? Blah, blah, blah. How men sometimes act. Well, anyway. But anyway, we were in France, and we lived, very nicely. What should I tell about my mother? My father was, we were selling paper goods, by hand. My father used to carry them and so on and so forth. And my mother decided, this is ridiculous, she's not going to schlep all this. She went somewhere and found a paper towel. And she put all the paper towels and the napkins and all that kind of stuff in there, covered it, and went merrily on her way. Except one day, she was waiting for the light to change, when a bicyclist almost ran over, standing there with a policeman, and he berated the man. Didn't you see the mother? The child is in there, and my mother went. was not in the place, you wouldn't look into the carriage. But anyway, she was able to get on the way. And my parents built up their business. My father got involved in the printing industry and was a part owner in the printing plant, in a printing company. And my father had his first heart attack. And he wound up in the hospital. And he told my mother if he ever, he had to get out because he had been wounded in the First World War. And he hated hospitals with a passion. How my mother got him out of the hospital against all the odds, I don't know. But she told the doctor, I don't care what you do, you better get him dressed. He wouldn't do that. My mother got him dressed, called a taxi, who didn't want to take him. But she got him home and she found a Russian doctor who barely spoke French and barely spoke German, but somehow or other, he got my father to get better, and life went on, and we had a very good life, my sister and I, and my parents. And then, of course, in World War II, my father was arrested by the French because he was of German descent and he was Jewish. And he was sent to a camp just outside of Paris. And my sister and I belonged to the Jewish Girl Scouts, and we were sent south. Just like the children of England were sent out of London because of the air raids and everything. My mother decided that she wanted her husband home. And the only time that you could go and see your husband was on a certain day. So she decided, well, she's not going to wait for that. So she found out how you speak to a general, French general, how to go out there, what to take along, and so on. And she got that all together. She found a coat, a fur coat, that went all the way down to her ankles. And she filled this in her very deep pockets. She filled this with cigarettes. You know, those little packages. And she went. Not on the day that was about, just she went. And she got off the train, she rehearsed how you talk to a French general. You have to say, mon général, you know, that's very polite. You cannot offer your hand. The general has to offer his hand to you first. You know, there's certain protocol that you. So she went around the camp in the back and saw some people standing by the wire and said, can you get Adolf Simon? My father said, what are you doing here? You're going to get arrested. You know, the police is going to come. And, no, don't worry. Everything will be all right. And she left and she went to the main part of the camp where all the officers were. And she came to the sentry and she said, I would like to see the general or whatever. Do you have an appointment? And she said, no, but I do want to see him. Oh, by the way, do you smoke? They all came to a couple of pockets, you know, came to cigarettes. But just a minute. So they went in and one of them came back and says, all right, you can come in. So this is the way she was transported from one soldier to another, handing out these little cigarettos, you know, all the way around. And oh my God, it was so happy until she got to right in front of where the general had his office. And there's somebody sitting there and said, this is Simon, you know, she introduced herself. Do you have an appointment? She said, no, but I really would like to see you. Well, let me see what I can do. So he goes in, and a few minutes later, he comes out and he says, yes, you will see him again with cigarettes. And here she is, the trunk of the general. And he, of course, is very surprised, doesn't know who she is. And she identifies herself, and she said, you have my husband here, and he's had already two heart attacks, and I think it would be better if you were with me. So we said, well, you know, we take good care of our people. She said, well, I really would like to have him, and we have a very nice conversation. So the gentleman gets up and he says, well, I will see what I can do. And he takes her to the door and he offers his hand, and she takes him, and he has an assistant sitting there, and she turns to him and said, do you smoke? And he says, yes, and then he goes, yeah, and whatever. And she went out, and she went back to the tent where my father was, and he's waiting, and he says, my God, what are you going to do? You know, she said, you're going to be home soon, believe me. And she went back to the station. She's waiting for the train to take her back to Paris. Now it's getting towards nighttime. And all of a sudden, a man approaches her and says, I want you to come with me. And she says, no, I'm not going to come with you. She says, yes, you're going to. I'm the, what do you call it? She's the
attaché.
I'm sorry?
Attaché.
You know, what? Yeah, not an attaché. He oversees the railroad station. He's the guardian or something like that. And he said, they're looking for you, because they knew that there was a woman there who was not legal, and they're going to come and arrest you. I want you to come with me. So he took her up. They had an apartment up there, and sure enough, the train came in from Paris, and they searched that train, that all, every single car, checked everything. And had to let the train go because they never found my mother. She's watching. So they don't forget also what I did forgot to tell you. This is in the month of January, February. The weather isn't so good. So they're very nice, these people. They wanted to stay overnight and take the morning train. No. She said, I'm going home. So she's looking out the window and she sees lights but at a great distance. And she said, what's that street? Well, that's the street that will take you to Paris. There are taxi cabs and cars. She said, okay, I'm going to go that way. She said, you know, the store is in, and it's a field, and no one knew. She insisted, so she started to go out. Of course, she lost the rubbers. She had these little rubber things that they used to have, you know, just a little bit over the top, and then you could lift in the back. She lost that. By the time she got to the street, she was full of mud and everything. She found a cab, told him to take her to Paris, promised to pay him twice the amount of his fare, and took her back to Paris. And she came home and she just said, I just dropped into bed. That was it. That was the end of me. About 10 days later, my father came home. And my mother had my sister, he come from the southern part of France, to Paris to be with my father. But then my father was home for about 2 weeks, 10 days. He was arrested again. And this time he was more in the southern part of France. And there was no way. But they had decided that they would meet where the children were, where I was, and my sister, and living with us. And I have to go back a little bit. My cousin came from Germany to live with us because his mother had passed away, his father had remarried, and there was disturbances in that marriage and, you know, the children. So he went to a Boy Scouts camp, and my sister and I went to a Girl Scouts camp. And then came an edict from Paris. So any woman who has 3 children in her charge and has 2 children living with her will not be arrested, will not be sent away. So my sister came back from the south because she had me and my cousin and my sister. So they found a train to take them back south because Paris was being blacked out so that the Germans wouldn't find it. My sister went out to get the paper, and she came back, and her face was all in black. They had smoke all over the place in order to, you know, the Germans shouldn't see where Paris was. But of course, you know, it was just an example of what the my sister came back and they packed up everything. And when they wanted to leave, they realized they couldn't carry all the suitcases. So they left an awful lot of stuff behind, did what they could, went to a railroad station, which of course was jammed with people, found a place, found a train going south, and it ended in a town. And the train said, "We're not going any further, everybody off." So what are they going to do? So in the town that they were, all of a sudden the airway went on, and everybody went into the airway shelters, and my mother said, "I'm not going." And as she's looking, she sees a group of people walking very slowly, very quickly, I mean slowly, but very determinedly, along the train that had stopped and onto another train. And she grabbed my sister, grabbed their suitcases, and followed them. And it was people who worked on the railroad who had a train right there that was going to go south. And my mother got on there, and she went. And of course, my mother had an accent, you know, with being German. But they said, "Oh, you must be from Alsace-Lorraine." Alsace-Lorraine went back and forth during the First World War, and it became Germany, and then it belonged to France, back and forth. So they understood that she had an accent, and she was, you know, they were very nice. They understood that she was from Alsace-Lorraine, and they ordered her food and everything that she would take. But anyway, and she finally wound up where I was, in a town called Beaulieu-sur-Dordogne. From what I understand, is today a beautiful summer resort. At the time, it wasn't. The people who lived there were farmers, and who thought that Jews had won. Really believed that. Until the priest told them, "We don't have won. We're just people just like you, except that we're Jewish." But, so she was there. And she didn't know where my father was. And she kept saying, "I have to get to a big town. I have to find a way to find your father." Well, anyway, the French retreated, and they were going through the town. And then there was a rumor that the Germans were coming. So my mother spoke to me. Sergeant or whatever, and she said, "Look, I'm Jewish," and he said, "He was Jewish, and we have to get out of town," and blah blah blah. And he said, "Okay, you stay in that house, but at 2 o'clock in the morning, I'm gonna come and get you, and you're gonna sit on the open truck, and we're going to take you with us." And at 2 o'clock he came. It was pouring rain. These trucks were open. There was no cover. My mother tied a string around our hands, my sister and I, so that we would not get lost, you know, or fall off the truck. So anyway, we got to the town, and the lieutenant came, and he said, "I can't take you any further." So then we're in this town, and the nuns had opened up the nunneries. You know, in those days, I don't know if you might know, they had porticos, and you could lie underneath, and you could walk and be protected from the sun or from the rain. The nuns had put straw there because the town was overwhelmed with people, you know, leaving Paris, leaving other places away from the Germans. So my mother and my sister and I would just plop, and we fell asleep. We woke up. My mother found other people that she knew, and when the nuns had opened up their nunnery, and they were feeding people and helping them, and we had a very nice dinner. And all of a sudden, he must have seen a lot of Humphrey Bogart movies, because he came and he was dressed in a raincoat and a hat like this, and he looked at my mother. He said, "You are the fifth column. You know, the fifth column is like the communist And he said, no, I'm not. He said, oh, yes, you are. You're the ringleader, blah, blah, blah. And I want you out of this town by noon, by dinner time, and I don't want to see you again. And my mother took it all very, very lightly. And she said, you know what, Jim? Stop worrying about it. Well, anyway, the next morning, we're at breakfast, and Mr. Humphrey Bogart came along. Are you still here? Stand on that tree. And he took all the people that she was with and stood on that tree, and he said, you come with me because you're the ringleader to my mother. And my mother said, can I take my daughter with me? And I didn't want to stay with all these people. And she said, don't worry about it, everything will be all right. So she was marched to town with six bayonets to the mayor's office. She waited a while, and she was called in. And the mayor was a very nice man. He asked her name, he asked about her children, he asked about her husband. And she said, you know, all my papers are correct, you know, legal. And as she's pulling out all these papers, a picture falls out. And the mayor picks it up. He said, who's this? And my mother said, oh, that's my youngest daughter. Her name is Ellen. Oh. She looks at my mother and he says, a woman who has a child like this is not of the fifth column. What can I do for you? So my mother, you know, she said, well, I need papers so I can stay here. I'm trying to find my husband and back and forth and so on. And there are other women, oh, just send them in, we'll get, I'll help them and so on and so forth. And Mr. Humphrey Bogart is waiting outside. And when my mother comes out, she says, good morning and goodbye. And she went and got back to where all the other ladies were waiting. And they all went eventually to see the mayor and got all their paperwork and so on. My mother was very lucky to find, we rented a room, which was right across the tannery, and believe me, you don't want to do that ever again, because if the wind goes the wrong way, never mind. Anyway, we found out that there was a bus going to more south, more to Toulouse. She wanted to get into a large city because she had heard that in the big city, some things had been set up so that families got together. Now, let's say you're looking for me. Okay, and I'm looking for you, but I don't know where you are, okay? So you go into a city, and you go to these people, and you say, I'm looking for my sister, Ellen, and they'll look and say, oh yes, we found Ellen out of Ellen. She lives, she's right here, in this place, and you come, and you meet her. And that's how families get together. I would have gone to, and I would have said, I don't know your name.
Elaine.
I would say, I want to find my friend Elaine, and your last name. And they said, well, yes, Ellen is over here, and Elaine, yeah, this is, you know, and that's how people got together. Again, men found their husband, found their wives, and wives found their husband, and their children, because everything was so in an upheaval at the time. And, but there was nothing there for us at the time. But you could also write to the post office. And if you went to the post office and presented your papers, you know, saying who you are, find out if there was any mail, you know, for you. And on this Friday night, my mother went, we went to the post office, just on a chance, and my mother said, do you have anything to get to sign from somebody who didn't give up, and the guy goes with me. There was a letter from my father. She opened it up and she said, I'm sick and tired of chasing you all over France, because my mother was going from one town to the next town to the next town. I'm tired of following you. I'm with where Rudy is, my cousin, and this is where I'm going to stay, and if you find me, you gotta come. So, oops, by the way, and we went. But I first have to backtrack a little bit. We were in a city called Toulouse, and it was teeming with people. The There wasn't a room to be gotten, an apartment, anything to stay in. People slept on the street because it was impossible to find a home. So my mother went into a hotel and she said, she asked for a home. She said, I have a room. She's looking around and she's seeing this big room and she's saying, what is that? And I said, well, that's the dining room. And it's empty. You know, people have come and gone and everything is. How about I sleep here on the floor? Can you let me sleep here on the floor with my two daughters? And he looks at her and he says, yeah, I will. He said, if you have a couple of blankets and a pillow, that'll help. And that's what he did. And we slept on the floor in that big room. So when we were at the post office, all our stuff was still at the hotel. My mother took the bus. She said, I can stay in the hotel. And she went to where my father was. Also a small town. He didn't sleep that night. He kept waking up. I gotta look at my children. I gotta look at my wife. Mm-hmm. It was impossible. But anyway, we all went back to Toulouse. We all slept on the floor. Finally, a room was opened up to us. And there was only one big bed. And my sister and I slept on the floor. But my sister slept underneath the sink. And eventually, we found an apartment. And my mother was horrified because across the way, and the whole house, you know, with it. Oh my God. She couldn't believe that. But anyway, and we met someone that they knew, and he was in the theater, and he was looking for the kids to sing some songs in a play that he was giving. And he saw me, and he said, she can come and she can sing. And another little boy also to come, and he sang, and my father would come and see the first thing. He would come and see me sing and everything, but he didn't want to come at night. We had visitors, you know, people, a rabbi, and some other friends, and they were either tall and had a beard. My father was short, had a mustache, he was a little bit heavy. Now these people were either tall, wore glasses, had a mustache, had a beard. And every time she would say, come and see my daughter play. And she would go to the theater and she said, and he would say, who's this? Oh, that's my husband. So every night she had a different husband. It was all right. But things got to be very bad. In Toulouse. We were doing the same thing as the day before, and we were closing off the streets. So we went back to Beaulieu, which where the Germans had never come, and we found a house that we lived in, and it was the only house that had indoor plumbing, and there were a lot of refugees there, I mean people that my mother, my parents knew, and other people that they just met. And in the winter time, we had a whole slew of people in the house using the facilities. Beaulieu was from the 18th century. There was no indoor plumbing. This was the only house, and it belonged to the mayor's daughter, and she rented it to us. In return, the typewriter that the mayor had wrote, and my mother, with, I don't know, insight, had a typewriter with us, and whenever they needed it, they would come and borrow it from us because we ran out of ribbon, and we still had enough stuff. But we lived there, we made some very nice friends and everything. But then things got to be a little bit tough. You know, things were not going so well. And my uncle, my father's brother, had sent us the papers. But my parents had put it in the room. We're not going to come, there's no war, it's not going to happen, you know. But things started to get very bad. My cousin, who was living with us, his parents, his father, and his new wife, the baby, died in concentration camps. His wife had a son, he was in the concentration camp, but he survived. His other brother went to Israel, and so he was safe. And we had papers just for my father, my mother, and my sister and I, but we didn't have any papers for my cousin. But there was a group of people who took children whose parents were not available and helped them to get out of France in the war and in the United States. So we were all ready to go and everything. And we even said to my cousin, you're going to be there first because he was going to go on a children's transport. Well, that didn't happen. And my mother called up the group and we said, he sent you the paper. He sent you the letter. The transport is gone and there's not going to be another one. But your letter was not there. And my mother said, I never got a letter. And a couple of days later, this man was living there, single. He came by, he says, oh, you know, I picked up my mail the other day. I saw the mailman the other day. And he was delivering mail. He said, give me the Simon mail. I will give it to them. I'm going there. But then I got involved in some of my own correspondence, and I forgot about it. And I found the letter just today. That my father didn't kill him right then and there, I don't know. I mean, my mother was holding on to him. There were other men in the house. And he said, get out of my sight. Just get out of my sight. Because what was going to happen to him, you know. But he went back to where the Boy Scouts were, and we left. And we got to Toulouse, you know, and we were supposed to go across the frontier in Spain.